So the year 2020 has been awful in most regards, but if you're on the market for a new mirrorless camera, it's actually an awesome year.
That's right. Many, many long-awaited releases are happening right now, and big announcements that look like a wish list. So with all these releases by all the leading camera brands, is 2020 actually a good time to buy a new camera? And are we buying a new camera? We'll tell you in the end.
Some of the features that we've been really looking forward to in an upcoming mirrorless camera include 4K 120 and a flip screen, and it looks like a lot of camera brands, including Canon and Sony, are starting to give that to us now.
And you can include IBIS into that, and Canon famously withheld it and argued even against its usefulness for so long, and finally gave in and offered IBIS in its newest releases. So let's talk about the upcoming big releases as well as a few existing cameras and what the landscape of the camera market looks like in 2020.
So on the Canon side, we have the Canon EOS R5 and the R6. I was actually planning to upgrade to the R5 this year until COVID came and destroyed my photo business, and I really can't justify spending almost $4,000 on a new camera this year.
That's right. So that camera seems to have just about everything you could ever want, including 8K, which you may not even want. In our case, we don't, and we'll explain why in a second. But really, it looks like the approach Canon took is they decided to put out the best, most powerful camera on the market in existence. And together with that, they're actually finally shutting down their DSLR business. They declared it dead.
That's right. So Canon has a new line of lenses, the RF line. They are more expensive than even Sony lenses.
So you're looking at really paying a premium if you are to go with the latest best release by Canon?
You'll pay the most. You'll pay about just over $11,000 without tax if you go for the new R5 plus all three of the RF lenses that complete the Holy Trinity.
Right, and if you wanted to save some money, you could actually get the lesser version, the R6, which is less megapixels but seems to offer just about all the other features.
But the lenses are still going to cost you over $2,000 per lens, which is a lot of money.
Yeah, and in the long term, actually, lenses are what matters, and not so much the body, which you keep changing.
If you go the Sony route, you now have the option of getting lenses by Tamron and Sigma. Those lenses are a lot cheaper, and they don't come with image stabilization as the trade-off, but neither do some of the Sony lenses. So you have the option of making your overall investment into Sony a lot cheaper if you go with a third-party option, and these third-party options don't really exist for a Canon RF, Nikon Z. Sony's the only one that has those options available.
Yeah, and Sony's own native lenses are really expensive, and I'm really shocked to hear they don't have stabilization, because that really makes you wonder why you're paying $2,000-$3,000 on a lens.
Only the telephoto does, the 70-200, but yeah, their 24-70, 16-35 doesn't have image stabilization, and they cost a lot of money.
Yeah, and compounding with that is the fact that Sony is not good at IBIS. They really rank around 4th or 5th when it comes to stabilization on their bodies.
Yeah, that's the excuse that they've given before, of that, you know, the camera bodies all have 5-axis image stabilization, so that means you don't need image stabilization in your lenses, but we beg to differ based on our experience with them.
Right, so it's interesting to consider the different approach that Canon and Sony took for their releases. The A7 S3 seems to be their flagship when it comes to video in particular, and they have rolled out a bunch of video features while they did not roll out 8K, and they said they did that to focus on the perfect 4K camera. So what did they actually give people this time?
So the A7 S3 has the ability to record in 4K 120 frames per second, which is slow motion in 4K. It also has a flip screen, making it a viable vlogging camera finally.
That's right, and you can use that in a studio setting and so on, and film yourself. So it's interesting that Sony chose to wait 5 years for this release and then give a 12 megapixel sensor to its users, which really makes it strictly a video camera, because what kind of photographer would buy a 12 megapixel photo camera in 2020?
So if you're on the market for a photography specific camera and you need the megapixels, you probably want to go for the A7 R4, which now comes with 61 megapixels, and it's the same price as the A7 S3. You could also go with the Canon EOS R5, which has 45 megapixels and is slightly more expensive though than the A7 S3 and the A7 R4.
But it does give you 8K.
Mm-hmm. If you really need 8K.
Well, right.
Which is a question.
It is a question we can address right now. And We ourselves don't want 8K because we barely can buy enough storage for our 4K videos.
In fact, I mean, hands up, tell us in the comments if you're even shooting 4K, because a lot of people, especially YouTubers, aren't even using 4K because the amount of storage it takes. You need a bigger memory card, bigger and faster memory card, hard drives, your computer has to be fast enough, then you need a fast internet speed to upload those videos. So even 4K is a stretch for a lot of content creators these days.
Yeah, and it really bloats the cost of your production. Mm-hmm. So we ourselves know that we're not going to be going there, given that almost no one has an 8K TV anyway, mm-hmm. and almost no streaming platform supports 8K. So with that said, there is no point for us, and it really just would be an extra cost that is not justified. And for that reason, the 8K offer on the Canon camera is really meaningless to us. I imagine someone will find it useful, but maybe a high-end professional that does big scale productions. I don't know who that
would
be.
That's right. If any of you actually end up buying the EOS R5 and shoot 8K, then let us know how it is, because it won't be us. So with all that said, who is the A7S III even for?
It seems to be for YouTubers, video makers who are really into video, they don't really care for photography, and they want the latest features on the body, but not necessarily a giant sensor. For the Sony user who is looking to upgrade their video capabilities, this was a long-awaited release. It is out now. It is quite expensive at $3,500. Is that what you have there? In the same time, there's a new release by Nikon, the Z5.
So Nikon is releasing yet another full-frame camera to add to their Z line. This one is called the Z5, and it's their entry-level mirrorless camera.
This camera by Nikon is actually coming at a super attractive low cost of around $1,300 or so, and that actually is cheaper than the leading crop sensor cameras like the Fujifilm X-T4, and a lot of people freaked out when they saw that and said, oh no, why would anyone ever buy a Fujifilm and a crop camera ever again if you can get a full frame for cheaper? And that's not a bad point to make. So we should also discuss previous releases this year like the X-T4 and why that camera may or may not be a good idea to buy at this point. And we ourselves are Fujifilm users, and X-T4 is a camera we strongly considered because it also comes with very, very good features like the IBIS and like the flip screen, and it has the high megabits per second. It has also the high bits of color and all the really the things that you would want. It's only thing that it doesn't have is a full frame sensor, which performs well in low light, and that's where these full frame cameras that we mentioned earlier are really going to beat the Fujis. Given that the market is already saturated with very many very strong cameras that many people own multiple ones like we do, is it really that good of an idea for these camera makers to make such strong releases at such high price points exactly at a year where almost all the photography businesses of the world have been devastated by lockdowns and the virus and all kinds of problems which make it actually difficult to justify upgrading?
I mean, you really can't blame them, because I'm sure that they've had this in the work for years, and you know, no one could predict how we're going to end up in 2020. But yeah, it's a really good question, because on the subject of, you know, how good are older cameras, I'm still using my Canon 5D Mark III. I've had that thing since 2012. It works just perfectly, and I'm sure that if I keep my A7R III or X-T3, they'll probably be good for 10 plus years down the line.
I've had my X-H2 for 2.5 years now, and I really have very little complaints, and I choose it over almost anything in the house, which includes even more expensive cameras and newer ones. But it really makes you wonder where the entire camera market is going, because I think it suffers from a very, very big degree of saturation. And if you look at recent sales, they have collapsed, like with really devastating percentages. And all the investment that went into these new releases may or may not be justified this year around. I think it's actually a good thing that releases have slowed down, and that people get to use their camera for longer.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no reason to be upgrading every 2-3 years or even with every release. I used to like Canon's model of, you know, every 4 or 5 years they'd have a new camera, so you could safely have that camera and not worry about getting the latest and greatest thing. But now they're coming out like every year, it seems. Sony is the most guilty of this. I feel like they're constantly coming out with new stuff, and it's like, stop, slow down.
Yeah, honestly, we don't need this. Mm-hmm. And with all that said, with the market being the way it is, what is the next camera that we'll buy? And in fact, we will buy a new camera this year. So
very soon, in fact. But yeah, it's going to be a GoPro. and we haven't yet heard any official news about a Hero 9, but there have been enough rumors, and I've heard that they're still on track to release something this fall, so that should be really soon.
Yeah, and we're so invested in GoPro, it has become our main camera for making our YouTube videos. There are many people that use it exclusively. It actually now at version 8 already makes very beautiful footage. There are some problems and some bugs we hope to see fixed at 9, so that alone and the fact that it costs $350 justifies it versus $3,500. Now we're talking about much more difficult camera to justify buying.
Yeah, I'd say it definitely comes down to cost, and for most of us, you know, we can't justify spending, you know, over $500 even on a camera, but for $350 or $400 or whatever it ends up costing, it'll be an affordable price. So
that's right. So our next camera will be GoPro 9.